Well, hello and welcome. What a terrific group that we have here tonight. My name is Jeff Todd, and I'm Executive Director of Alumni UBC. Whoops, there went the placeholder. There we go. We'll put that there. I'm Executive Director of Alumni UBC and the Associate Vice President for Alumni at the University. And I want to start off by welcoming everyone and also acknowledging that we are gathered on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people. I want to thank all of you for carving out the time to join us this evening to listen to our five incredible speakers talk about the genomics revolution. Tonight's program is brought to you in partnership between the faculties of medicine, dentistry, and pharmaceutical sciences, as well as Alumni UBC. We have you, our live audience, right here in Vancouver, and we also are live streaming this event online, which means we have viewers from all over the globe, and we would like to welcome all of you as well. So we'd like to take this opportunity to thank our gold sponsor, Genome BC, and also thank you to our bronze sponsor, MD Management, for their support of tonight's UBC event. I hope you'll join me in thanking our sponsors for making this evening possible. Now, usually at this point, we would actually encourage you to turn off your cell phones, but don't do that. We would like you to mute your cell phones, but I actually want you to bring them out because we'd like you to tweet the event at Alumni UBC, and the hashtag is UBCMedTalks, all one word. And one of the other tasks I have this evening is to tell you about our online tool that we're going to be using for the Q&A following the five presentations. So if you have a mobile device, a smartphone, tablet, whatever you have with you, we'd like you to take 30 seconds right now and pull that out. And we would like you to go to alumniubc.cnf.io. And the URL is going to be projected on the screen. And you'll also be able to access Wi-Fi by connecting to UBC Visitor. The audience engagement platform, this is going to allow you to ask questions in real time throughout each presenter's talk. And we'd like you to write the presenter's first name before your question so that I know who to direct your question to on the screen. And on the screen, you'll see an example right now. I'm taking it for granted that it's actually behind the screen for me right now. And then other attendees can actually like your question, and when we get to the Q&A portion at the end of the program, I'll be able to pose some of the top questions from the audience to the speakers, because we will have a limited window for questions. Again, the URL is alumniubc.cnf.io, and we'll be sharing that URL on the slide deck throughout the program. So for a trial run, though, you will note that we have populated a polling question related to this evening. So if you, and here's the question, and you'll see it on your handheld devices. If you unwrap all of the DNA you have in your cells, you could reach the moon how many times? All right? So we're going to give you a minute to answer the question, and then we'll see how many of you actually get it right. All right? So I'm going to wait a couple of minutes. And then eventually they'll put the results up on the screen. I'm saying with great confidence they're going to put them up on the screen. Do I need to get my handheld device? Okay, so 50% of you said 6,000, and the 50% of you would be right, all right? So I'm sorry we weren't able to show it on the screen, but just so you know, that's the results. So we will be able to use that later, and you'll be able to ask your questions, and we'll be able to see them when we get to that portion. So you're now ready to participate, and we really want you to input the questions as the speakers are presented, and just don't forget to list their names. And now it's really my pleasure to introduce Dr. Michael Cofftree, the Dean of UBC's Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. Dean?
Thank you very much, Jeff, and good evening and welcome, everybody. It's a great pleasure for me to be able to participate in this wonderful event with my colleagues from the faculties of dentistry and medicine. And I think that sums up the content of the evening is about collaboration and partnership. Our students work together in an interprofessional environment, but the lineup of speakers highlights the absolutely critical nature of collaboration and partnership in harnessing the power of genomics from the most basic studies of the role of genomics and the mechanisms in which genetic information is transferred to getting it into clinical practice, to supporting patients who are receiving genetic testing and information, highlights the importance of collaboration and partnership across the sciences and the healthcare disciplines if we are to harness the power of this technology in improving the outcomes of healthcare for the patients here in British Columbia, in Canada, and around the world. I'm looking forward to hearing all of the speakers, and I'm now like to introduce my colleague, Dr. Chuck Schuler, who is Dean of the Faculty of Dentistry here at UBC.
Thanks, Michael. Welcome to this evening. I'm glad we're having these MEDTalks, and I'm looking forward to this series for a long period of time. I think you're going to find some very interesting science that's happening at UBC, and as Michael said, the collaborations that occur between the different health disciplines. I think understanding genomics and proteomics is a fundamental process that's here, and what you're going to see is this does cross many disciplines. From our Faculty of Dentistry, Dr. Chris Overall and his many colleagues have been very engaged in this process for a long time, and they've been working on the degradation of proteins in the cell, and he's created an entire new field of degradomics. So what are the fragments that are in the cells? And I think you'll find it fascinating to find out that as a pathologist, I always thought that degradation was just the end of the disease process, but it actually might be much more stimulating by signaling new things. In our Department of Oral Biological and Medical Sciences, many of these things are happening all the time, and they're working together across the campus and helping to move these processes forward. So I'm looking forward to a really exciting evening. Thanks for coming, and I think you're going to enjoy the evening. And now it's back to Jeff, right? Okay.
All right, thank you, Dean Schuler. And now, as you will see in your printed programs, Dr. Catalina Lopez Carrera, the Chief Scientific Officer for Genome BC, was meant to moderate tonight's program. I'm obviously not Catalina, but unfortunately, she has lost her voice tonight. And so I have a bit of the unexpected honor of introducing our incredible speakers this evening and then chatting with them on stage during the Q&A. And during each presentation, I hope you'll input your questions on the audience engagement platform. So the sequencing of the human genome is one of the most important breakthroughs in modern biology and is allowing us to use the human genetic blueprint to address important questions ranging from human origins to the understanding of health and complex diseases. As a result of the dramatic decrease in cost and the advancement in sequencing technologies, we are now much better equipped to understand the role genomics is playing in our personal variances and the interactions between genes and the environment, and how these are shaping our health and our communities. How can this knowledge be used to improve human health through disease prevention, diagnosis, and personalized treatment approaches? What does the genomics revolution mean for you and your health? What is the potential for future generations? I'm very much looking forward to hearing all of our experts in their fields talk about their research in genomics and answer these questions. Now, to introduce our presenters, and please understand we have to cut down all of our presenters' bios significantly when introducing them, as each of their achievements and experiences are quite extensive, as you can imagine. Our first speaker is Dr. Janine Austin. Dr. Austin is an associate professor with UBC's Department of Medical Genetics, as well as Canada Research Chair, Translational Psychiatric Genomics. She investigates the effects of genetic counseling for people with psychiatric disorders and founded the world's first specialist psychiatric genetic counseling service, which has now helped about 600 families in BC. Tonight, she will discuss the role of genetic counseling in stimulating healthy behaviors. I hope you'll join me in welcoming our first speaker, Dr. Austin, to the stage.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Is my microphone on? Yeah, okay. Thank you very much. So as you've heard, we're here this evening to talk about the genomics revolution, which sounds great in a fuzzy, nebulous kind of way. But what are we really talking about? What does the genomics revolution actually look like? Well, I think most of us tend to imagine all kinds of sleek, shiny, high-tech devices that, with nothing more than a speck of blood, will tell us what our health future holds. And ideally, they'll also tell us what kinds of personalized pills we should be taking if we were to get sick. But in an ideal world, we wouldn't have to get sick in the first place. What if we could use genomic information as a way to motivate people to engage in behavior changes that would reduce their risk for common conditions that we face as humans? Cancer, heart disease, diabetes, mental illness. In fact, this is one of the golden grails of genomic medicine. It's one of the key pieces of the genomics revolution. So let's think about this a bit more seriously. Okay, so let's say you had a genetic test that told you that you had increased risk for heart disease. You'd use that information to eat more healthily and get more exercise, right? Okay, well, maybe, but perhaps not so fast. Let's see if I can shed some light on it from a different angle. So how many of us, by show of hands, know that nutrition is really important in reducing our risks for all kinds of different kinds of health conditions? How many of us, though, are always really good about choosing veggies and water over fries and beer? Oh, there's a couple of you, well done. But you get the idea. So by our own admission, information alone is not enough to get us to consistently change our health behaviors, okay? And, sorry, I've lost my train of thought for a second. So, yes, information alone isn't enough to get us to change our health behaviors. But, you might say to me, if I had a genetic test result that told me I had this increased risk for heart disease, that would be different. I would eat right then, right? And that's what scientists thought, too. We thought that genetic information would be different. So, there were some studies. And then there were some more studies, and yet more studies. And in the end, there was a study of all the studies, and we call that a meta-analysis. And unfortunately, what all of these studies together showed was that genetic information is not enough to get people to change their health behavior, to reduce their risk. So this was, to put it mildly, pretty disappointing, because this is one of the key pieces of the genomics revolution, after all. But there is some good news. I and my team have been having some success with using genetic information to help people make behavior changes to reduce their risk. Woo! Haven't done any slides, have I? Okay, information is not enough. We've also just seen that genetic information is not enough. So I and my group have been having some success, and what we found is that to help people make behavior changes, we require two things. The first thing that we need is a coherent story for people that links their understanding for cause of illness together with the risk reduction strategies we're suggesting. And the second thing we need is to address people's emotions. That's critical. So I'm going to share a story with you that will illustrate how this can work, and it's about somebody we'll call Jane. Jane is a composite of a variety of people. So Jane was 50. She had a job that she loved and that she was really good at. She also had bipolar disorder, and everybody at work knew about this and was really supportive, but her mental health wasn't good. She had to keep taking lots of time off for depression. I met Jane because she came to see me for genetic counseling. She wanted to talk about the chances for her daughter to develop bipolar too. She felt it was going to happen at any day now. So when I meet with people as a genetic counselor, one of my first questions is always to tell me what they understand about the cause of the illness that they have. Jane's explanation was simply genetics. As it turned out, she'd actually experienced a whole bunch of really stressful life events in the immediate run-up to her diagnosis, but she didn't think about those as having anything to do with it. So I talked with Jane about the research evidence showing that bipolar is caused by combined effects of genes and our experiences acting together. I had to work really hard to get Jane to hear this, and when it finally sank in, she was horrified. She explained that she would not have been okay with anybody knowing that she had bipolar disorder had she known it was anything other than 100% genetic, for fear that people would blame her. So I spent quite some time counseling her around this fear and around this shame. And I also worked to help her see that those life events that she'd experienced weren't things that she could justifiably be blamed for. So aside from taking medication, Jane really wasn't doing very much to take care of her mental health. So we talked about the research evidence that sleep, nutrition, exercise, good social support can all be really helpful, and how if she were to use some of these strategies together with her medication, perhaps she could be doing better with her mental health. We also talked about how these same strategies could be helpful in protecting her daughter's mental health, and how it was far from a foregone conclusion that she would also get sick. At one point, through tears, Jane told me, if we'd known it was anything other than just genetic, we would have had more children. We went into some pretty heavy emotional stuff together. 1 month after our appointment, though, Jane's mental health was much better than it had been in years. She was doing her best to eat more healthily. She was going for a walk every day. She was working to get, she'd actually lost 10 pounds. She was working to get better quality sleep, and she and her daughter had signed up for mindfulness meditation classes together. So Jane was able to use the information that I gave her in order to make behavior changes to reduce not just her risk, but that of her daughter as well. To do this, she needed two things. She needed a coherent story linking the explanation for a cause of illness with the treatment and risk reduction strategies we were suggesting. Initially, she'd thought her condition was entirely genetic, biological in origin. So the only treatment strategy that made sense to her was biological medication. So in order to except that there were things that she could do to take care of her mental health, the genetic information had to be contextualized. She had to understand that it wasn't entirely genetically determined. So importantly, all of the other common conditions that we face as humans, you know, heart disease, cancer, diabetes, these all arise as a result of combined effects of genes and environment acting together. So we could use the same approach. The other thing that I think the story shows us quite nicely is that people's explanations for cause of illness have deep and powerful emotional connections. In order to act on the idea that there were things that she could do to protect her mental health, Jane had to accept a new model for her illness explanation, right? And that meant that she had to confront the regret of not having had more children, and she had to confront her vulnerability towards others' judgment. So the counseling piece was absolutely key. You have to address those emotions. So the counseling component of the genetic counseling is really what matters here. So I think what we've been doing in medicine for a long time is working under the assumption that genetic information on its own is enough, and it doesn't matter how we deliver it. As long as people understand, that's fine. What research shows, what we now know, is that genetic information alone is not enough. And what my group's research is showing is that in order to help people, we need to give them these things. We need to give them a coherent story linking their explanation for cause of illness with the treatment or risk reduction strategies we're suggesting. And we also need to address the emotions that can act as barriers to behavior change. So I would argue that if we want to be able to help people to use genomic information to engage in behavior change, to reduce their risk for common conditions, we need to exploit the skills of genetic counselors, because they truly hold the key to the genomics revolution. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Janine. That's a wonderful start to the evening, so thank you. So next we have Howard Lim, from the Faculty of Medicine. Dr. Lim is a medical oncologist at the BC Cancer Agency, specializing in gastrointestinal cancer. He's a clinical physician professor within the Medical Oncology Division at UBC and program director of the Medical Oncology Training Program, as well as the chair of the GI Tumor Group. Dr. Lim is also an active member of the GI Outcomes Unit and the Personalized Oncogenomics Program, a clinical research initiative that's embedding genomic sequencing into the diagnostic and treatment planning for patients with incurable cancers. Tonight, Dr. Lim will speak to us about the pitfalls and successes within personalized care in oncology. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Lim to the stage.
Thank you very much for having me and inviting me here. It's great as a actually UBC alumni. I did my med school training here, my grad school training here. University's changed a lot. I actually got lost trying to find this building. So, So on behalf of the Personalized Oncogenomics Program, I'd like to just talk about what we're doing here at the Cancer Agency. So I'm sure you've studied this blueprint before in your science classes, but this is basically the roadmap to the building of a cell. And what cancer really is aberrations in this roadmap that leads to different structures and basically growth and proliferation of normal cells, which essentially is cancer. So what we're aiming to do is, if we can understand this blueprint of someone's cancer, can we figure out different ways of treating and personalizing care for that patient? So what we traditionally have done is treat people based on their tumor site. Lung cancer, colon cancer, breast cancer, we have chemotherapies for those different disease sites. But what we've learned over the past 10 to 15 years is that actually not all lung cancer is the same. So as the technology has evolved, we can now sequence and profile different lung cancers, and actually we're seeing different populations. So in this slide, you have EGF positive lung cancer, ALK positive, fusion positive, and these patients then respond to different types of drugs. And we now have developed more targeted agents targeting different pathways. So now we have more drugs in different populations who are not actually treating lung cancer all the same. We're actually finding subpopulations that who will actually respond to our medications. So the Personalized Oncogenomics Program is about basically gene profiling. And what we're doing is looking at different genomic alterations within the cancer cell. So there's various whole host of different things that happen. There's mutations, there's structural rearrangements, alterations, fusions, deletions. But the other thing we also look at is gene expression as a surrogate marker of what's happening, how are you translating that blueprint into the protein. So the gene expression is sort of like a surrogate to the protein level. And this is an interpretation of the data. So what happens is we do all of this, and all the bioinformaticians at the Genome Science Center comes up with this roadmap for a patient. So this is a particular patient's breast cancer. You can see it's hypermutated, so this might respond to newer drugs like immunotherapy. We see driver pathways, looking at the FGFR pathway, maybe that might be driving this patient's cancer. So can we use that as a target? So now what we're trying to do is figure out what is truly driving someone's cancer and theoretically maybe targeting this. So I have some examples. So the first case is actually a patient with lung cancer, and she underwent sequencing. And we found a novel fusion in the NRG pathway. So it was thought that, well, this is interesting. So we went through the literature and found a drug, afatinib, blocks this pathway. So this is on the left side is her CT scan, top image is her lung, and the bottom image is her liver. You can see basically a large tumor in the lung, and in the liver there's numerous shadows. After starting basically genomically directed therapy, here we are on the right after two cycles of chemotherapy, you can see a dramatic reduction in the size of the mass in the lung, as a significant decrease in the disease in the liver as well. So this woman actually stayed on her, with metastatic lung cancer, stayed on her treatment for almost a year and a half. And normally, if we look at the number one, in terms of number one killer for cancer, it's actually lung cancer. Most people live less than a year. So here she's doing much better than the average due to personalized therapy. Case two is actually gallbladder or bile duct cancer or cholangiocarcinoma. And here, the example I'm trying to show is this patient had the exact same fusion. So we're like, well, worked in the lung cancer. Let's try it in the gallbladder cancer and see what happens. So here we're now translating knowledge from a different tumor site to another tumor site. And once again, this is the pretreatment scan on the left. This is the patient's liver. It's a CT scan. Numerous shadows, that's all the disease in the liver. And after two cycles of chemotherapy, once again, you see a significant reduction in disease burden. So again, now we're translating knowledge that we're taking from each patient. So we're now, instead of personalizing the care, we're now applying the knowledge to other tumor sites. So we're trying to expand it towards a population. But realistically, where can we stop and where does this go? So here are where the pitfalls are. First of all, we need to make sure we're getting the right sample. So it starts off with the biopsy. And then there are certain assays out there which are really just looking at point mutations, which is PCR. But then as we go along the pathway, we get more and more information. So there's whole exome sequencing, the whole entire genome. And then we're looking at expression patterns. And now we're looking at the protein levels. So you'll hear more talks about, well, how does the gene express, or how do the genes manipulate proteins? And then we also have to look at how each person metabolizes the chemotherapy as well. So how I, we do know that levels of chemotherapy also matters. So your genetics will also predetermine how you metabolize chemotherapy, your toxicity levels, et cetera. So in that way, we still have a ways to work on. Right now, we're just working on the cancer part, but we still have to work on the person part of looking at, can we spare people certain toxicities? Can we figure out the proper doses based on your genomics as well? And that's a whole nother arena that we haven't even touched yet. And where it comes down to now is really we're very fortunate we get to work in partnership with great researchers, and it is a partnership. So at the Cancer Agency, we're very fortunate we have the Genome Science Center, which is world leading in bioinformatics and sequencing. And so we can take innovation and discovery, move it through POG, and then look at can we apply this across a population and move this into clinical trials to make it broader. Because right now what we're doing is we're drilling everything down to a person to make it personalized, but if it works for one person, can we make it work for other people? So now we gotta look for the population. So now you drill it down and then you re-expand it. And then we focus back and it's basically a circle of collaborative research, innovation, and we keep cycling it around so that hopefully we help more people and get the right drug to the right patient at the right time. So really, we want to thank all the patients and their families for enrolling in this trial. It's been really exciting. This has really been funded by the BC Cancer Foundation, but it's really done in partnership with the Cancer Agency, Children's Hospital, and the Genome Science Center. So there's about 350 scientists at the Genome Science Center that's really been involved in this. We meet every Thursday to review every case. It's a fantastic collaboration where we're actually taking what's going on in the lab and moving it into clinic. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Howard. It's really great to understand a little bit more about the tremendous value that genome sequencing has in the fight against cancer, so thank you. Our third speaker is Dr. Martin Dawes from the Faculty of Medicine. Dr. Dawes is the head of the Department of Family Practice at UBC, co-founder of the Personalized Medicine Institute. His research includes genomics in primary care and lifestyle interventions to prevent diabetes. He is currently leading a new research project entitled The Implementation of Pharmacogenetics in Primary Care in British Columbia. Tonight he's going to explain why it's not just the genetics that is difficult, but the translation to everyday practice is also really hard. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Dawes to the stage. Dr. Dawes.
Thank you. Thanks very much for the opportunity to try and make sense of some science. The work that we're doing is about trying to prevent adverse drug events. This is not new. An article that I dug out from my Lancet archives, we try to do no harm. So how many here have had a side effect to some sort of medication or members of their family? Okay, so people know about this stuff, and our work is to try and prevent that. Now, hopefully, those were mild side effects. Unfortunately, it can get very severe. This is an example of a mother who was breastfeeding, who was given codeine for the pain after the birth, and who knew, but she had a variant in her system that translated that codeine to morphine far more than we would normally expect, resulting in a huge overdose of morphine going through to that baby in the breast milk. Our work is to prevent that. If we could do that genetic test that would have detected this before that woman was given codeine, we could avoid these sorts of tragedies. So I'm just going to talk about Jane. Again. So Jane's been helped by this amazing person, and she's come in to see me because she's now got arthritis, she thinks, in her knee from all the activity she's doing thanks to the counseling she's got. And she's going away on holiday tomorrow. And it's a typical family physician sort of interaction. So she's here, could I have something for my knee? I think it's arthritis, and I'm away on holiday tomorrow. So I examine her, I take a fuller history, I identify what she expects from this. I identify she's actually luckily going on a cruise up to Alaska, so I'm becoming jealous. And I say, okay, well, we could give you an anti-inflammatory drug. She turns to me and says, I'm working with this brilliant person who's doing a lot of genetics, and I wonder if I, you know, should I, is this safe for me to take? Well, an anti-inflammatory taken for a few weeks is not going to be harmful. So you're okay to do that, and then I'll see you when you come back from your cruise. So she says, yes, I'd like that, and could I have a repeat prescription for my antidepressants? So I give her the drugs, write the prescription, and 3 weeks later, I get a phone call from the emergency room. And it's Kendall Ho. He's calling me, Martin, I've got Jane in ER. We're transferring her to ICU. We've transfused her with 5 units of blood from a hemorrhage. And she said she was taking a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory. Was she on warfarin, which is the commonest interaction to cause the bleeding? I said, no, she was on an antidepressant, but that was it. And so we're both puzzled that someone should bleed so heavily 3 weeks after taking an anti-inflammatory. We had both forgotten that the combination of her antidepressant and the anti-inflammatory drug increases the risk of bleeding by 4 times. It's a very common situation. I cannot hold all this stuff in my memory. And unfortunately, those adverse events happen incredibly frequently. So every 3 minutes in Canada, someone has an adverse drug event of that sort of severity. And 20,000, 22,000 are killed by those events. It costs the health system. And our prescribing is inappropriate. We give these prescriptions, and when you look at them, they're harmful. 14% are high risk. Genetics is important, and I'll come to that in a second, but it's only one part of a complex process. So our work in genetics was translating to a safer form of prescribing. This is what I have going on in my head when I'm having that conversation. What's the renal function? What's the liver function? What are the drug-drug interactions? What are the disease-drug interactions? What are the patient trying to get out of it? What am I trying to get out of it? What's the safety system here? It's too much. Okay, so 2017, what's the state-of-the-art decision support for me as a family physician? That's it. It's called RX Files. I'm not joking. We have 170 residents come into our program in July the 1st. This is what they will get. It's not just family medicine residents. It's the best knowledge there is. But it's not helping me in my prescribing. So here's the process. I make a diagnosis, I identify the treatment options, I select a treatment, and then if I've got a clever system, I'll get an interaction alert. But it's like being told the undercarriage is down just as I'm about to fly into the tarmac. It's too late in the process, and we need something upstream. So to put genetics into a system that was already broken made no sense. So we changed the system for prescribing. We took all the information and put it upstream, so people now put in the diagnosis and get the safe, effective options. It did take a bit of time to do it. It took about 100 people over 4 years to come up with the first prototype. And we created a panel of tests for drugs commonly seen in primary care, where we look at 74 drugs and their metabolism. At the moment, we've got nearly 800 drugs in our system, 14,000 different rules, 3,000 different options for those 25 conditions. It's massive, which is why no one's done it before. And here are the genetic results. This is a sample, 190 people in British Columbia. And if you look up at the top, citalopram was that drug that I was giving Jane. And 27% of patients have a variant that alters the metabolism of citalopram, so that actually I was giving her a higher dose than I thought. So now she was on a triple risk, drug-drug interaction and drug-genetic interaction. And look at the bottom one, codeine. 10% of patients have abnormal variants variants for abnormal metabolism of codeine. 7% don't convert it into morphine, and 3% convert it into morphine far too rapidly. So nearly all of us have a variant for those common drugs. So we thought, okay, let's take this and commercialize it, because it's fine to do the academic work, but could we actually put this into practice? 9 months later, we've got a commercial product that's out there now, available to people, but it's at a price. So we need the evidence to persuade the government that this should be reimbursed. This is an example of a 19-year-old who took a cold remedy, may have seen it on global TV, and unfortunately had a massive reaction. We want to prevent that happening, but it means giving the test to everyone. For that, we need government's reimbursement, and they will need the evidence. So we're doing a large study, 4,000 patients in Canada. We've applied for the funding for that. We're going to put this into electronic medical records. We're going to increase it to 150 diseases. And UBC is going to be leading a global initiative to prevent those sorts of disasters happening. Thank you very much.
I don't know if you're like me, but you actually want a little more than just a few minutes on each of these topics, and I have to say they're doing fabulous, so thank you. It's amazing the work that's being done. Our fourth speaker this evening is Dr. Corey Nislow from the Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences. Dr. Nislow is a Canada Research Chair Tier 1. He's an associate professor within UBC's Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences and also director of UBC's Sequences and Bioinformatics Consortium. After completing his undergraduate degree at New College and his PhD at the University of Colorado Boulder, he led discovery teams at two biotechnology companies and at Stanford University. If that wasn't enough, he has also run 18 marathons. Tonight, he's going to discuss the lessons he and his lab have learned in their search for how genotype is revealed in phenotype and how they are applying that learning to patients. Join me in welcoming Dr. Nislow to the stage.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and also thank you very much for the first three speakers for saving me a lot of time and helping me put things into context. But saving me time is what I'm really appreciative of. So I've borrowed my talk title today from the biologist Theo Dobzhansky, who borrowed it from a French philosopher. And for me, it's perfect because it gives me a frame which I've always used to look at science and biology, but it also gives me, if you will, a canvas that I can paint my particular scientific story for you and tell you a couple of stories. So this here is another quote that I kind of try to live by is, you are what you love, and you should love what you work on. And I've been working for 30 years on a variety of different organisms. I started with I started with sea urchins as an undergraduate, moved to frogs, worms, algae, eventually mini pigs, and finally humans. I've sequenced myself. I have not yet sequenced my dog because she is impossible. The point of this slide is that all of these different organisms share a common DNA ancestor. And we've also decoded the DNA from all of these critters, and we know that they're actually, we know that they're a lot more similar than they are different, and we've also learned some incredible surprises from each of these organisms on their own. But I'm going to focus on my favorite, baker's yeast here, why yeast? Well, we domesticated yeast about 20,000 years ago, and they've been making our lives better ever since. And my lab uses yeast to understand how human drugs work. You may think this is a really big stretch. You were all separated from baker's yeast by about a billion years of evolution, yet, despite that distance, we share about half of our genes with this simple organism. And although, as far as I can tell, yeast don't have brains, we have been using them very successfully to understand the mechanism of action of many different types of human therapeutics, including drugs used for depression and other mental health disorders. And that, again, is because of evolution. There are proteins in yeast, on the surface of yeast, that respond to small molecules that look and act, and for all intents and purposes, are drugs. This is how yeast communicate. And so by using this simple system, we can understand at a very basic conserved level how drugs and genes interact. Another really nice thing about yeast is that they're very open to you manipulating their environment. And as we've already heard, it's not just genetics. Environment has a key role in the gene-drug interaction. And so we're always looking for new environments to explore. And so when NASA contacted us, and they had the last shuttle mission scheduled for 2011, there was always a shuttle on standby, and they decided to fly it to the International Space Station. And they offered us the opportunity to take our yeast gene drug experiments and see how they act in microgravity. Well, not just the cool factor excited us, but this was an incredible challenge. It was a challenge to us to see if we can get our ground-based experiments to work on the International Space Station. Because if they can work there, they can work anywhere. And it was actually incredibly good preparation for our pharmacy DNA project. So here's the astronaut doing the experiment in space as we followed along doing the ground controls. And I wish I could tell all of you that our pharmacy DNA project was easier than this, but it actually wasn't. It was a little bit harder. So let's come back to Earth, and I want to tell you just a little bit about our project, which has its philosophical similarities to what Dr. Dawes just described, just a different care provider and a different venue. So in our project, we sought to ask the question, why aren't we using genetic information, which we know affects drug dose right now in the pharmacy? As you were told, we have about 300 billion bases of DNA in all of our cells, in all of our trillion cells. But we're 99.9% identical. So there's about 3 billion differences between you, between me and Dr. Dawes and Janine. There's about 3 million differences. And we can argue about how many of these differences we can take action on today, but we're just going to focus on 300 genetic variants for which we know if you have a particular variant, you will respond to a particular drug in a particular way. And so why aren't we using this information today? Well, there's no good reason. DNA sequencing costs are not the issue. In 2001, it cost $3 billion to sequence a genome. You can sequence a genome today for about $1,000. And this isn't just nice because it's better to spend $1,000 than several billion, but the more data you have, the more sequences you have, the better data you have. Because if you're looking at 300 variants in a population, and I think Dr. Lin mentioned this, you need to get populations in order to personalize your medicine, to know, to have the statistics to say, if you have this variant, you will respond this way. So in our phase one study, we said to ourselves, well, pharmacogenomics works. And how do we avoid this hype cycle here, where we've been sitting on the peak of inflated expectations for quite a long time and not willing to jump over this trough of disillusionment and land on the plateau of productivity? And just like the space station, and in the interest of time, just like the space station, I'll let you know it's all about logistics. And you'll have these slides, they'll be online, so I'm not going to go into the details, but the logistics cannot be underestimated, as Dr. Dawes just mentioned. So we wanted to make sure that no matter where you were in the province, we would get the same results. So we blanketed the province in a number of 33 different pharmacies. We collected 200 DNA samples, and the data we got back was comparable. So fantastic. Catalina is not here from GenomeBC. Thank you, GenomeBC, for the funding. We accomplished our goals. We accomplished our goals. No patients dropped out of the study. And most encouragingly, the patients were incredibly enthusiastic about the project. So in the interest of time, I'm going to tell you we're moving on to phase two. We're rolling out more patients. This time, we're going to be returning information. You could say there's an issue here because there's some risk involved in this project. But I would come back and say there's some risk in online banking. The challenge is, what is the risk that we're willing to take? I would say Canada, as the only G7 nation that does not have a law protecting against genetic privacy, we need to change that. So look it up. Look up Senate Bill 201. We're going to test the hypothesis that pharmacists are indeed the frontline healthcare providers who can provide this information back to patients. And so I'll finish with this slide here. The reason we should do this is not just because it's a good idea. It's because there, just by way of example, 1 in 5 Canadians are suffering from mental illness. And while there are a lot of very good drugs, some of which we've tested on yeast, that help a lot of these symptoms, it's primarily a trial and error process. And this trial and error process takes a lot longer than it needs to. Just by way of example, here's not Jane's, but my personal word cloud of medications that I've had the luxury of experiencing over my 20 years. And I can tell you, pharmacogenes and variants can get you to the, or can steer you to the right drug a little bit faster, get you to the right dose a little bit faster. And if it's 10% or 20% faster, those are days that you wouldn't give back. And so with that, I'd like to end, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Corey. And I don't know if you realize just how painful it is to ask five outstanding research to condense what they have to say to you in 5 to 6 minutes. So they're doing great tonight. Thank you. So our fifth and final speaker this evening is Dr. Chris Overall from the Faculty of Dentistry. He's a professor in Tier 1 Canada Research Chair, Protease, Proteomics, and Systems Biology in the Department of Oral, Biological, and Medical Sciences within the Faculty of Dentistry. After completing his undergraduate degree at the University of Adelaide and his PhD at the University of Toronto, he was an MRC Centennial Fellow in his postdoctoral work with Dr. Michael Smith here at UBC, learning protein engineering. This evening, he will be talking about the Human Proteome Project and whether or not proteomics can fill the gap between genomics and phenotypes. And it's my privilege to welcome Dr. Overall to the stage.
For the millennials in the audience, this thing is called an envelope. And when I did my PhD, our mail came in envelopes. But the second great use for an envelope is its back. On the back of an envelope, one can do calculations. So in my PhD, this was also the cloning era. And the back of the envelope calculations were that we had about 120,000 genes in us. So the big surprise came in 2001 when the human genome sequencing data came out in back-to-back publications showing we had only 20,000. So how can we get this great complexity that makes us what we are with such a small parts list? This is a big question, and I hope to address this today by telling you that it's beyond the genes and it's the proteins that are giving us the answer. We have 20,000 genes, yet a cabbage has 40,000. Cabbage is very complex, it turns out. And on the one gene for one protein assumption, a bus in London has 24,000 different parts and is way more complex than us. Yet we know that unlike us, which can heal and have wound repair, a bus does not auto repair. Just ask any German mechanic to discuss his opinions about English motor mechanics. Unlike us, buses can't reproduce. I guess you could have sex on a bus, but buses don't have sex. A related question, though, is how do these same 20,000 genes that are homologous between different species give us such different phenotypes, from worms to flies? Well, the answer is in proteins. Proteins are what make us what we are. There's around nearly 20,000 protein-encoding genes, but with things called alternate splicing, we can increase the diversity of genes. Brings up to, we now know there's 42,000 annotated splice variants. And with alternate start sites and with post-translational modifications, we now have millions of different protein forms. And these are called proteoforms. So post-translational modifications are chemistry that is added to the side chains of amino acids in a protein. So when you think of a line is interesting, but it has two differences that are that define it from the rest of the protein, of the line. We have a start and a finish. And in this case, the start allows things to run, and in this case here, this is very much the end of the line for a fish. So a protein also has different ends. We have a C-terminal and an N-terminal, and they add unique properties to a protein. Now, I've been fascinated in a family of molecules called proteases. These are enzymes that degrade proteins. And this is important for things like digestion and removal of old and worn-out proteins in us. But more than that, that's boring, actually. It's important, but boring. In addition, we have very precise processing where a protease will cleave at one or two sites very efficiently and lead to two or more chains. And these often have different functions compared to the intact protein, with different new ends, neoprotein. So the question is, do these new neoproteins or new termini have different functions to the parent protein? So we really started to investigate this in my early days of my lab here at UBC. We set up what was called a yeast 2 hybrid screen using a protease. This is the domain that we hypothesized was binding substrates. And in one of Corey's yeasts, we found that it pulled out this protein, a chemokine called CCL7. And what it does is that this presents this hemopexin domain, drives and pushes the molecule towards the active site, leading to cleavage. And so what we have is a removal of just four amino acids from the N-terminus. But what it does is completely change the function of that chemokine from being an agonist to an antagonist. It goes from a go signal to a no-go signal. So what are chemokines? In injury or disease, alerts are sent out, and these are called chemokines. And these are molecules that are beacons that set up gradients in tissue, and the idea is to recruit white blood cells to the site of injury. The first line sense of cells are neutrophils. They make two proteases that we showed takes off the first five residues of the chemokine and then activates it, converting it to a go signal. You then get a chemotraction to the site of injury. And it happens by the millions. And it keeps on coming. So what turns it off? If you have white blood cells always coming, you're going to have worse disease. This next set of cells that come in are macrophages. And they release a protease called MMP12. And that converts and turns off that go signal. They also have their own chemokines, the one I told you about, CCL7 and CCL2, that attract the macrophage to the site of injury. And again, the same enzyme turns off that signal to stop the white blood cells from coming to the site of injury once the bacteria are gone and once the damage is being repaired. What's really important here is that the off signal in biology is actually just as important as the on signal. You don't just cruise up to the traffic lights. and take your foot off the gas pedal and hope you stop. You actually put the brakes on. And that's what proteases we're finding are doing more and more. They're dynamically controlling the signaling networks that control white blood cells and other cells in the body. The yeast-2 hybrid system is great, but it's too slow. So we turned to proteomics. We developed a technique called TAILS, where we can enrich for the yellow N-termini of the protein, because we know this holds so much information that that is necessary to understand biology. And if we have a protease working in the system, this is cleaving that proteome, generating these neo-N-termini, the new N-termini. And together, what we have then is a fingerprint of the processes that are occurring in disease. And these are mechanism-informative signatures or biomarkers of tissue or disease. It's staggering, the extent of proteolysis. It's staggering the extent of what we don't know from just genomics. This is the data we generated from our skin. 44% of the proteins have a different end terminus to what's annotated in the gene bank databases. Nearly half, and this goes up in inflammation of the skin to nearly 60%. And you can imagine now that the functions that we were hypothesizing that were working from seeing, say, chemokines being present, we wouldn't know if they were go or no-go signals unless we knew the terminus, that terminal information. So our hypotheses on the biology of the system and our ways of thinking about are these good or bad players in the disease could be completely wrong. So we're a big part of the Human Proteome Project that's run by HUPO, the Human Proteome Organization. This is the next step past the Human Genome Project. The idea of HUPO is to employ large-scale proteomics analyses of tissues in order to locate and identify all the human proteins and their proteoforms. And with this, we hope to understand biology and disease in a great depth beyond the gene. As you can see, we've had these proteolytic biomarkers that give us very precise information as to the state of the disease. Is it on or off? Is it go, is it no go? And so we are hoping to deploy, the Human Proteome Project is going to deploy human proteomic markers as informative biomarkers for precision personalized medicine. The protein evidence so far is that there's 16,500 proteins where we have proteomic evidence for the protein existing in man. There's an additional 2,000 that we have genes that we know the RNA is present, so the protein should be present. That leaves us over with nearly 3,000 missing proteins. And this is a large part now of the collective effort of HUPO is to find these 3,000 proteins. How many of them could be involved in disease? How many of them are completely untargeted by drugs? How many of them could unlock the secrets of curing of a disease? And how many of them could we use as new biomarkers to diagnose and follow treatment? And finally, as I've been telling you about the proteoforms, this task doesn't end in 3,000 more proteins. We have to now take on all the different proteoforms and the different PTMs in order to fully understand the true complexity of the human proteome and cells. So this is my summary slide. This Japanese artist took knives and forks and spoons and he welded them together to make this sculpture of a motorbike. Now, if you were a reductionist biochemist, you would take this thing apart and you'd have knives and forks and spoons in your hand. And you conclude from this cutlery that the function of that would have been to eat. And you'd be totally wrong, of course. What you have to do is step back and look at things in a different light. In this case, from a point light source. And what you see is that mess actually does form a sculpture. And the important message is, it's not the individual components that gives information. It's the connection between the components. What I've been describing tonight for you is the connection between proteases and proteins and signaling molecules and how that informs and give us information on how the disease progresses. So thank you.
So thank you, Chris. And I'm going to invite the rest of our researchers to join me on the stage here, and we're going to get to some of the questions that you've asked. Nobody's going to fall, right? Okay, good. Well, so I'm going to start with a bit of a general kickoff question here for all of you. And then we have a number of questions. The audience is, I haven't counted them, but there are a large number of questions that we'll try to get through a few of them at least. But it's clear that there are great advancements in genomics, and there are already some examples of the use of genomics in clinical practice in BC. But most of them are pilot projects or isolated initiatives. So how can we ensure that BC leads the way in Canada and internationally in the implementation and use of genomic technologies in clinical practice? Anyone like to start?
I'll jump in.
Great.
I think the way we ensure that we get to the, at least get started down the path and leave the starting gate with pilots is I think you saw some of it tonight, in that there's no one way to do it, and there's no one, and that means there's also no one best way to do it. So we have an incredibly well-trained healthcare workforce, and we need to enlist as many of them as possible towards the goal of using genomics and educating patients and empowering patients. So it's a multiple shots on goal approach is how we're going to go forward and have the ability to fail along the way.
Yes.
So I think actually we are building on that. We've got great advantages in BC, and interestingly, we're known around Canada as the province that's really moving forward on genetics and not just pilot projects. Our government has been engaged with Genome BC, supporting their work for a very long time financially, and supporting the projects that we're doing as well, and other agencies in BC have been doing that. So I think that the government is one partner. I think that the physicians and the academics, the other health professionals, the pharmacists are all engaged in this. And that fertile ground actually lends itself to implementation evaluation strategies. So moving forward from pilot projects to something that's sustainable.
So interestingly, this is something I was talking about earlier this afternoon at Genome BC at the Winter Symposium, exactly this question. And just to sort of carry on really with what Corey and Martin have both been saying, I think that one of the keys to making this really work is interdisciplinary collaboration. And so we already know there's lots of research studies showing that family doctors, with my good friend here excepted, of course, often feel rather uncomfortable and uncertain about how to implement genomics into their clinical practice. So one of the strategies that I was suggesting this afternoon at Genome BC that we could talk about was implementing a system whereby we're integrating genetic counselors throughout all disciplines of medicine as well as family practice, given that this is a population of healthcare professionals who are trained to do exactly that, to sort of take genomic information and translate it into meaningful differences for patients. So I think interdisciplinary collaboration is really important to make it happen.
And I think that's a nice segue, and I think you've started to answer this, but I want to say that at the very top of the questions right now is the question about are doctors in BC ready to embrace and use genomics in their practice?
Mm. Martin?
No.
I think it depends on your specialty. Yeah. So in oncology, it's really quite on the forefront. If you look at pretty much most of the national meetings, it's about how are we incorporating more biomarkers. Number one, the drugs are fairly pricey for oncology, and they're toxic. So we want to make sure we are truly getting the right drug to the right patients. So at the Cancer Agency, we already have a standardized panel which screens our patients for various chemotherapy drugs. So it does depend on, I think, your specialty as well.
I asked a group of family physicians this morning that very question. And they're doing genetic tests all the time. They're taking family histories all the time. So they're used to actually using genetic information, albeit it's taken from family history rather than the genetic test, but it's not a huge leap to say I'm taking a risk derived from a genetic test as opposed to a risk derived from a question about your mother or father having a certain disease, to talking to you about lifestyle changes and maybe therapeutic options. So I think we are ready. It's how it's actually disseminated is going to be really important.
If I could riff off of that, I think what we're talking about here, although not naming it, is building a network of providers and a network of information. And just as the specialist, you would not look at cardio drugs in particular. And as the family doctor, Martin, when I saw your slide about all the things that's going on in your head in that 1 minute, I got a headache. we need to integrate the individuals in the healthcare workforce, and I do need to put a plug in for pharmacists as individuals who are drug experts. Yeah. They're agnostic drug experts, and they do have more than a minute. Yes. And so this, I think, if we can build the network where it doesn't come, the information doesn't come in, but comes into this node and goes out to the specialists and avoids the drug-drug interactions that Martin described, avoids the emotional anxiety that Janine described, I think we can come up with a network that works.
I think also...
Chris, and then Chris.
Yeah, I was speaking with Peter Cullis, who's the director of the Life Sciences Center, yesterday, and we're putting in a grant in on personalized medicine. So he's got a system that's been developed here at UBC, where for $1,000 in basically a day, we can get 70,000 SNPs, genetic SNPs are sequenced, 300 specific genes sequenced, and 300 metabolites analyzed from a patient, from which the idea is to then develop a very small snapshot to give to the doctors for personalized medicine where this can make a change in diagnosis or in treatment. But I think part of the answer has to come also, though, from having being an Apple fan for a long time of Steve Jobs. You've got to keep these interfaces very, very simple at the end, because as we saw with that giant complex roadmap we had at the beginning, the very nice interface that took a year for the drug interaction map. We need something very, very simple that can be on your phone that the doctors can use very quickly to quickly pass down through the data to come up with an accurate readout for what these biomarkers mean. But it's going to be an integration of a whole lot of biomarkers, including proteomics.
I do want to just draw our attention to the fact that we've become very information-centric again, right? And I want to bring us back to the key of my talk, which was that we know that genetic information alone is not enough. And we can't really avoid entirely, you know, the emotional, the anxiety that goes along with it. You know, what my work is showing is that in order for it to be effective in helping to engage people in behavior changes that do reduce their risk or engage them more in treatment and so on, we actually have to address those anxieties. And so, you know, I don't think that it's helpful for us to get into sort of territorial disputes about whether it should be MDs or should be pharmacists or it should be genetic counselors. Like, I think that really the key is about what's in the best interests of the patients and how do we make that work the most effectively and as quickly as we can. And that is going to require that we all work together.
Yes.
Yeah.
Howard, you'd want to say anything else you wanted to say?
To expand on that, it's really, I think, the fear from professional side is, are we doing tests out of the context of the patient? Are we getting, are we getting genomic information without understanding the phenotype? And that can really be quite confusing and leads to the anxiety to the patient and leads to anxiety on the professional part as well, so.
I told Janine I was going to ask her a question, but I have one more I want to ask the group, and then I'm going to get to the question. One of the other questions is, what are the diseases that benefit more or most from genetic testing? Howard, do you want to?
For us in oncology, we're very suited for it. I mean, cancer is a disease of the genome. I mean, it's aberrations. But having said that, I think you could look at pretty much any disease site, and there are genomic aberrations like cardiology, rheumatology, the list goes on and on. Okay. So, yeah.
I think any further comment on that? Go ahead, Mark.
The answer is it isn't one disease. Okay. I think it is just about every disease. And if you're the individual with that
right,
disease,
exactly.
It is the most important thing to have a genetic test
for. Right, yeah.
Because it's all about the person. So I don't think you would say we need to look at depression more than cardiac disease.
But just before you ask Janine her question, I just want to,
you see how hard it is to prompt these folks,
yeah.
right? I have the easiest job in the world.
Building off of what Martin said of this burgeoning recognition that that British Columbia is becoming a thought and action leader in genomics, I think a really nice corollary to that is we're starting to take the fear out of genetics and genomics. And a big part of that is the realization that it is not all mm-hmm. genetics and genomics. Mm-hmm. It's lifestyle, it's nutrition. Mm-hmm. There's a reason I run. And the reason is figures into my genetics and my environment and how they interact. So I think this is, again, gets back to your first question, how and why is BC leading? And that's because we recognize that your genome can help, but it's part of a bigger, it's a bigger calculus.
Right. Anybody else? Okay.
I'll get back to the question too about how BC is leading. It's been through very strategic investments by the provincial governments, by bringing in great scientists to UBC like Mike Smith, for setting up foundations like Genome BC, the Michael Smith Foundation. And the thing is, these technologies do cost a lot of money. A single mass spectrometer is $1.3 million, and they go out of date in 3 years. So these are the types of things we need to keep this powerhouse going at UBC. We've got this fantastic campus now. I mean, it really has come together in the last few years with these great new buildings and these integrated sidewalks and lampposts and things. It looks very, very nice now. So we all can be really proud of it. But underpinning all of this, so are the people who are here and the people who have been recruited here by the university administrations and by the funding that's being provided. And that's all really critical too.
Great, thank you. Okay, Janine, ready for the question that I told you I was, are you ready? Okay.
Ready.
So what does the genome tell us about mental illness?
It's a lovely question. The cynical answer would be not very much, basically. There are no genetic tests that we can use to diagnose mental illness at this point in time. Diagnoses of mental illnesses are made based on clinical interview. So what we do know, you know, as you've kept hearing over and over again in this little discussion here, is that, you know, with the rule of thumb is basically that all common conditions that we tend to be affected with as humans, so, you know, cancer, heart disease, diabetes, mental illness, these are all things that are so common, in part because we all have some genetic vulnerability to them. Right, we all have some genetic vulnerability to them. So they arise as a result of the combined effects of our genetics acting together with our experiences. So genetics will only ever give us a piece of the puzzle about the explanation for the cause of mental illness, really. Yeah.
Thank you. Martin, what are the costs of applying the commercial genomic testing to reduce ADRs?
So at the moment, we've got about half a dozen companies selling these sorts of tests across Canada, and they range in price from about $400 to $800. Ours is at the lower end of that, and the software is part of that process. And the individual will actually be able to see the result and then put in their disease, answer questions, and then the drugs listed are the options for them.
Okay. Let's just look at my list here. Okay, so Corey, how does knowing patients' genomics compare to trial and error dosing to determining which dose of drug to use?
How much time do you have?
1 minute.
Yeah. there is no comparison. We talked about Martin talked about warfarin. Mm-hmm. My starting dose would be 5 milligrams. My starting dose should be based on 2 letters in my DNA, should be half that. I don't want to end up in the hospital for a number of reasons, but I also don't want to cost the province thousands of dollars to treat me. So to get back to your question, how does it compare? That's for one drug. The aging population takes multiple drugs. Mm-hmm. They interact with each other and with your genetics and with your environment. Mm-hmm. So as Janine keeps saying, and I keep agreeing, if we can start to take into account just the low-hanging fruit of the 300 variants, Martin's 800 drugs, and act on them, there is no comparison. A day saved could be a life saved, or a month saved could be a life saved. So I really, I'm glad I can't answer your question.
It's not my question, but I asked it. I do want to mention that if any of you did not enter something on the system, we do have folks with microphones, so if you just identify yourself. But if you do ask a question, we do ask for questions because we want to try to keep the conversation moving. Howard, which factors are considered when trying to expand personal therapy to population-based personal therapy?
Million-dollar question. I think realistically what has to happen is you have to sequence basically thousands of patients, and you're then looking back and trying to figure out the pattern. So there are a number of initiatives going around the world. We're part of the TCGA. In Europe, there's actually looking at expression panels for colon cancer and looking at different expression patterns and now regrouping what we used to think. So instead of colon cancer being colon cancer, there's actually now 4 or 5 molecular subtypes. Breast cancer, there's like 20 molecular subtypes. So it's kind of, you need to first, I guess, we're really reclassifying everything. So I think this is just going to take more time to figure out and learn new patterns.
Okay. Chris, and I'm going to kind of give you a couple of questions. One is, how are software programs and computers being used to discover new proteins and potentially drug targets? And then the other question is, can you tie proteomics to the vast amounts of non-coding DNA?
Software is unbelievably important. I mean, these machines, as I indicated, are sequencing now. We can get now sometimes 18,000 proteins being identified. Sometimes there'll be more than one identification of the same protein in single experiments, and do that type of analysis on the fly. It's all software in the data acquisition. But I don't think the question meant that. It really means on how do we analyze the data afterwards and compare for database searches. Luckily, most things are on the web, but it does take an enormous amount of time to pass through the data and to look for the relevance and to look for the identifications. In my own lab, for instance, we have something like 4 servers, 200 terabytes of storage. These are constantly being updated as the data is coming in off the machines that are running 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, generating the proteomic data. So, but it's looking for in silico prediction of proteins from genes. Yeah, I mean, we know from the parts list of the human proteome that the coding genes, we have about 19,500 coding genes, and we know that there's about 3,000 to go. We can do structural analysis, structural modeling of some of these proteins based on known structures. This is important. We can do in silico docking of drug candidates to the active sites of these enzymes or other sites, allosteric sites, for working out potential modalities of blocking these targets. The software is really, really important. The computing power is really important. We're getting these things on apps on phones now, which is just staggering. But basically, there's still going to come down to actually pipetting and getting the samples onto the mass specs and analyzing the data at the end of the day.
Thank you. Do we have a question in the audience? Okay. So genetic counselors play a key role, but we do not have enough in BC. How can we reach a critical mass of genetic counselors in BC?
Yeah, so BC currently has about 50 genetic counselors, which is increased fairly substantially, scarily enough. We do have a training program in British Columbia. It's currently the largest one in the country. We take 6 students a year. And we're in active planning mode for how to increase the capacity of that training program. I think that's really one of the key pieces. So this isn't just something that's affecting BC, it's affecting, I mean, genetic counseling was identified as one of the top 10 growth jobs in the US last year. It was sort of plastered everywhere you looked. They're estimating growth rates of 27% over the next few years, which is way higher than the average growth. So there's huge opportunities for genetic counselors in terms of job markets. So we really are trying to plan for how our training programs can meet that demand.
Yes.
So there is an educational need for patients and for professionals to understand more about before the test is done. Mm-hmm. There is a great site done many years ago in the United Kingdom called Database of Individual Patient Experiences, which took issues such as should I have a prostatectomy or should I wait after I've had a diagnosis of prostate cancer, and what's it like as an individual. And there would be videos of patients going through that process of maybe over weeks or sometimes months of experiencing what it's like. And in the case of genetic testing, we could start to create those sorts of stories, which would be really helpful. We still need the counselors, but we need the supportive information as well.
Yeah, I think that's really important. I mean, just to, you know, to maximize the resources that we do have, you know, what genetic counselors are uniquely placed to do is to really, the genetic information is important, but in the context of this counseling-based encounter, so for sure, I think there are definitely ways that we could be looking at to provide more of the information outside of the counseling so that only, yeah.
Corey?
Yeah, I just want to say, and I think it relates to everything that has been discussed tonight, and it's also a shameless plug for the University of British Columbia. The VPR, the Vice President of Research Office, has, during the past 2 years, broke ground on a new effort in advanced research computing, and that effort supports the data that Chris talked about, the data that Martin and Howard talked about in terms of, you know, after a project's done these days, you don't just put your lab notebooks on the shelf. The data lives on, and hopefully the data improves as more research is done. And as patient experience data gets incorporated, phenotypic data gets incorporated. So that is another area of that distinguishes our university as really a leader in pushing advanced research computing as a separate discipline.
Yes, Chris.
In answer to the question also about how do we train more genetic counselors, now, I used to be a dentist, and one of the things you learn is to motivate people hate to actually go to the dentist. Now, that's the second most surprising thing I've told you tonight. Everything's got the sex in the bus.
That's why we're all here.
But I actually like it. And so you actually have to spend a lot of time with patients doing preventive dentistry and talking through it. What is needed in medicine and in dentistry and all the healthcare professions is empathetic practitioners. And I think we can't just palm it off onto some subspecialty thinking that someone else is going to handle the problem. The frontline workers have to be able to talk to patients and understand some simple basics and spend some time with empathy to understand the problem and to see them through with what the drugs, do they even need to take the drugs and what's going on in their life and are they having marital problems or whatever. So it's not just, I think we should also just concentrate on giving some patients some time.
Absolutely.
So we have had a tremendous response in terms of questions. Unfortunately, and I'm actually, I've already been given the signal here, but I'm gonna ask one final question that I hope each of you could just touch, just give us a quick, very brief answer to, but I think I'm certainly interested. And that is, I'd just like to know what first drew you into the field of genomics research. So if we could start here, Martin, and just work our way down, just a quick answer.
So the short answer is that I was asked 20 years ago by a man called John Emery, who now works in Australia, to complete a questionnaire about how I would look after a patient with a BRCA1 gene variant with breast cancer compared to a woman without. And it was that first question that made me realize genetics is not the future, it's now, and that was 20 years ago.
I honestly fell into it. So I sat on the research ethics board, and the protocol for POG actually came across my desk. So when I read it, I'm like, oh, this is how we're going to start treating cancer. And so I actually approached Janessa Laskin, who's actually the lead investigator, and said, how can I help? And it's just been a roller coaster ride since then.
Yeah, so for me, I kind of fell into it too. I mean, sorry, it's not a great story. In the UK, you sort of specialize in three subjects only from the age of about 16, and mine were chemistry, biology, and math. And the bits I enjoyed the best were the biology and chemistry, so I thought, I know what I'll do at university, biochemistry. So I went to university and did biochemistry, and the bit that I liked best of that was the genetics. And so I did a PhD in genetics, and here we are, yes.
Okay, I'll, short version, I was did my PhD in a biochemistry lab, and I had my hands on a really interesting protein, and I had done everything I could to understand how this protein helps chromosomes separate, but we ran into a roadblock. We didn't have enough of the protein, and someone had to clone the gene. And embarrassingly, this was several hundred years ago, I got my PhD by cloning this one gene that encoded the protein. Yeah. And as soon as we cloned the gene and decoded it, four other labs realized they had been working, not on the same, thankfully, but on similar proteins. We all got published in Nature together, and I realized, hey, there may be something to this genetics thing. And
well, I can take great pride in saying I didn't fall into genomics because I've never done genomics. I did proteomics. And so I have to thank my professor in my second year of dentistry, who said to me one day, one afternoon, overall, what are you going to do with your life? And I said, I'm going to be a dentist. And he said, no. He said, bullshit. He said, you're going to be a scientist. So after my PhD, I then became inspired to carry on doing my postdoc. And it was Mike Smith. So he's a geneticist, and he developed, of course, site-directed mutagenesis. So I guess he was the second main motivating factor for me to come to from Toronto to here. But it always came down from mutagenesis, came back down to the proteins. And to me, I've been always just fascinated by proteins because I think proteins are what make us what we are.
So Chris, Corey, Janine, Howard, Martin, thank you for those fascinating and wonderful presentations. And it's, thank you. And now I'd like to introduce Dr. Dermot Kelleher, the Dean of Faculty of Medicine, who's going to share some closing remarks.
Well, thank you very much to all of the speakers and to Jeff, and I think that warrants another round of applause. It's been a fantastic evening. And I also, just looking at this big, big crowd, that's not an alternative fact. If you want to look around you, it's real that we've got an enormous crowd of people here. Thank you so very much for coming out tonight. It's fantastic to see our alumni here, and it's also fantastic to see some of our emeriti here. Also fantastic to see some of the next generation of researchers, people who have brought their families. Wonderful. Thank you very, very much indeed. I think we're looking at a really momentous time in the history of medicine, dental, pharmaceutical sciences. Look back over history and you look at the times when things have changed dramatically. You look at William Harvey, the discovery of the circulation. That changed things in an extraordinary way. You look at the discovery of penicillin, the idea that we could treat infections for the first time. in a meaningful way. And then we've got these sets of events happening, the discovery of DNA, that Nobel Prize winning discovery. We've got the discovery of PCR, the polymerase chain reaction, the way that the mechanism that allows us to do things quickly, that allows us to clone genomes and determine whole sequences. And we've got Michael Smith here at UBC, a Nobel Prize winner, who, through identifying site-directed mutagenesis, allows us to make sense of what these genes do in real time, in real animals, and make sense, begin to make sense of what the genetics means for human disease. So right now, at this moment, I think you've seen tonight, we're at a point, we're at a tipping point, aren't we? We're at a point where the genomic revolution that we're talking about is here. The next 5 to 10 years are going to see extraordinary changes in medical, dental, pharmaceutical practice. And we're going to see implementation in a way that we're just beginning to see, as you'll have seen tonight. Here at UBC, we have real leaders in this space. You've seen the cutting edge. You've seen personalized oncogenomics. You've seen genomics in primary care. You've seen genomics in the pharmacy. And you've also seen how those genes translate into proteins and how those proteins interact and create another level of complexity. But equally importantly, you've seen the human face with Janine's presentation, because all of this information means nothing if we can't translate it into our treatment of patients. And if we don't have people asking the questions that Janine is asking, that is, what are the life events that lead up to a mental illness on a genetic background perhaps, if people don't ask those questions, then we don't make sense of the patient's journey, and we don't make sense of the genetics, because, as we've heard, genetics are complex. We need really good medicine to make sense of genetics. We need people to ask questions. We need people to examine patients and document that information accurately. We need to capture the data in a comprehensive way. So I think you've got a couple of little glimpses into the world of genomics at UBC. It's a much bigger world. There are a wide range of fantastic researchers here, all the way from basic science, as Corrie has articulated. Corrie showed this wonderful slide with all of these model organisms, and it's a reminder as well that when we think about science, and when we think about people working with worms or flies, those creatures have the same genes as us. What we understand about cancer comes, a lot of it comes from yeast. I haven't seen the depressed yeast yet, but you know, that's something to come. But what we understand about cardiovascular science, we're learning from fish, from flies, from all kinds of model organisms. That worm that Corrie showed you is telling us about aging, and it's maybe got some of the best clues in terms of the process of aging. So what's all this mean, and where is it going? Right now, the choices that we make as medical practitioners, as dental practitioners, as community pharmacists, are based on the old paradigm to a large extent. That paradigm is changing. One size does not fit all. Understanding the genome tells us how we should treat people. It tells us how we treat individuals in a personalized way. Personalized medicine teaches us how we treat patients in a precise way. Precision medicine. And that is the future. How we get to that future depends on scientists like these scientists that you've heard tonight. It also depends on our ability to make sense of that that complex information, and that involves, as you've heard, advanced research computing, the capability to analyze the data and bring it down to what Martin is doing, which is creating pathways for people to make choices that will inform the decisions that practitioners make in a simple and effective way. So I'm going to close by saying thank you to our partners, Alumni UBC, represented by Jeff, who has very kindly stepped into the breach to chair and moderate this session. I'd like to thank the Faculty of Dentistry and the Dean, my fellow Dean, Dr. Charles Schuller, and Faculty of Pharmaceutical Sciences and Michael Coffrey. We're all colleagues here at UBC, and I'd also like to thank all of my colleagues at the Faculty of Medicine. I see Pascal Spottlefair down at the back, and he's representing Genome BC. Genome BC have made enormous contributions to the advancement of genomics in British Columbia and to the leadership position that BC holds in this space. And also like to thank MD Financial Management and Irving K. Barber Learning Center for their support today. Just want to close by saying that this is not an ordinary evening, and this is not an ordinary set of speakers. Here at UBC, I believe that we have some of the most extraordinary scientists at that interface of taking complex science and turning it into new tools and new ways of looking at disease. I've been here for 18 months, so I'm seeing it a little bit still from the outside. And when I came here first, well, I was just struck by the extraordinary translational capabilities here and the extraordinary pace of movement from the bench all the way to the bedside and all the way out into the community. We here have just seen earlier on the 2MS, the UBC logo. It can mean it's up to you, or it can mean it's yours. But what it does mean for I think all of us who work here is that we are part of a community here in Vancouver and in British Columbia. And you, as alumni, are also part of that community. And I'd just like to ask you, as we wind up the evening tonight, to just think about what you've heard and to spread the word. Talk to your friends about what you've seen here tonight. It's so important for us that we get this communication with the community that we represent and support. And it's so important to us that if you're talking to people that you appreciate, I think that we have a very special thing here. We have a very special university that's focused on changing the lives of the people that we represent. And so I'd ask you to talk to your friends. If you live next door to a politician, talk to that politician and tell them of the great work. As you know, it's complex, it's big science, it's expensive work. We hope that some people in our community will hear more about this extraordinary movement and this extraordinary revolution in medical science that's taking place right now. And we would like you to play your parts in communicating that. So thank you all so much for coming here tonight.